Yeah, so in this video we are going to talk about confidence intervals. So confidence intervals for our classification error or classification accuracy estimate from the test set. And here we are going to use the normal approximation method for doing that. That's the simplest method. And later we will talk about some better methods for doing that based on resampling. So we are right now still in the basic section, discussing basic confidence intervals using the normal approximation method. And then in later videos, in the following videos, we will talk about different resampling methods. We will first talk about the repeated holdout method, but then we will also talk about resampling methods such as bootstrapping to construct empirical confidence intervals, which are a little bit better than these normal approximation intervals. Because in practice also, in traditional machine learning, we have sometimes smaller data sets, so the bootstrap methods are a little bit better for confidence intervals. Okay, so yeah, the normal approximation interval, where should we start? So let's start with the binomial distribution, which you surely remember from other statistics classes. So the binomial distribution gives us the number of successes. So the parameters of the normal of the binomial distribution are n and p, where n is the number of trials and p is the success probability. So the mean of the binomial distribution is n times p. So for example, if I have 100 trials, that is n, and then I don't know, probability of 0.3% success probability, then the mean of this distribution would be then 30, right? So here, this is on the left-hand side showing us how the binomial distribution looks like for different values of p and n. So I just took this from Wikipedia because I was a little bit lazy. So it gives us the probability density. So it's a probability density function here for the different number of successes. And one more thing, the variance is n times p times 1 minus p, because we will be using that also. So also take a look at this one. Okay, so then the binomial distribution. So here it's just a probability mass function, because it's a discrete distribution. And you can think of it as the number of successes from Bernoulli trials. So you probably also recall that, because it's an infamous example, or the most boring example in the world, coin flips. So we could then define the coin landing on head as a success, and then landing on tails as a failure. And then we can have a probability of successes. So how many, what's the probability that the coin lands on head? If we have an unbiased coin, it would be 50%. In practice, how do we get p? You could flip the coin, 1,000 times. And then from that, you can estimate the probability, right? So if you have 1,000 coin flips, so that's your n. Well, let me make this differently. Here, let's say you have 1,000 coin flips. This is your n. And you find that 500 of them land on head. So then this is your k. So in this case, you have a 0.5 probability. So this is your p, your probability of success. So you can empirically estimate that by counting the number of successes divided by the number of trials. And then here, the mean, the average number of the binomial distribution is n times p. So for example, if we have a probability of 50%, you have 100 trials, 50 would be your mean. So that's it's kind of k, it's the number of successes, so n times p. This is the Bernoulli trial. How does it relate now to machine learning? You can actually think of the 0-1 loss as a Bernoulli trial, right? Because in the 0-1 loss, we have also two possibilities. We have correct, so correct classification, and incorrect. So you can think of it as incorrect, because we have the error here. You can think of the success as incorrect and failure as correct. So this would be at your head. Let's do it differently. This is our tail, and this is our head, or heads in the coin flip. I'm afraid of touching my iPad screen here, because then it always flips a slide forward, even though sometimes I use a cloth, so I'm My writing is not very pretty. I'm sorry, I have to somehow find a better way to write on my iPad. Anyways, so yeah, we can consider my zero, or the 0-1 loss as a Bernoulli trial. And then we can also compute the true error as a probability of correct predictions, basically. So I was just using the fancy notation here. So f of x, a true function, just think of it as y, your class label, and h of x, our hypothesis. We can also think of it as y hat as our prediction. So empirically, if we have a sample. And so the true error is considering all the data in the world. What's the proportion of these being not equal, that would be our error, and the proportion of these being equal would be our accuracy. So if we consider all the data in the world, we don't have that. We usually use our test set to estimate that. So we estimate the true error empirically. So instead of talking about the probability, we estimate the probability by the proportion. So here I was just using, again, unnecessarily complicated notation, like a direct delta function. But you can just think of it maybe as an maybe identity function. It's easier. And it's 1 if, so think of it as a piecewise function that returns 1 if, let's use y and y hat. 1 if y is not equal to y hat, because we talk about the error here, not the accuracy. I mean, the same thing would apply for the accuracy, but for some reason I was using the error here. I think you know why I use error sometimes, because it sounds better if I say generalization error, because it's something people usually talk about in papers and stuff instead of generalization accuracy. So maybe that's why I'm always using the error here. Anyway, so and it returns 0 if y equals y hat. Okay, so, and then it counts the number of incorrect predictions, and then we sum up over the number of incorrect predictions, and then divide by n. So this is just the proportion of incorrect predictions, which is our classification error. That's nothing new. Okay, so I was just highlighting some similarities with the 0-1 loss, the Bernoulli trial and the 0-1 loss. But yeah, one major aspect is that the Bernoulli trial is like for the count data, so the number of successes, but we are interested in proportions. So there's just a very tiny difference. It's instead of looking at, or let me say it like this, the binomial distribution that we looked at before would be the number of errors, the number of incorrect classifications. But usually, instead of saying the number of incorrect classifications, we talk about the classification error as a proportion, that is a value between 0 and 1. Why do we do that? It's a little bit more intuitive. If I tell you, I don't know, my classifier has a classification error of 600, then okay, is it a lot or is it not a lot? It depends on the data set. If it's a data set consisting of 1,000 data points only, tested of 1,000 data points, then 600 is a lot, so we have a 60% error. But if we talk about 1 million data points, then this would be a very small error. So in this case, we usually divide by n, by the size of the test set, so that we get a number between 0 and 1 as the error. So the binomial distribution is a count, so what do we do? We just drop this, right? So from the binomial distribution, we just talk about the proportion, so we drop n, and we also drop the n here, so we just talk about the proportion now. So here, that's what I have for the variance, just the proportion, and then the standard deviation, the square root of that. And here I was just writing down the standard error. So yeah, recall from other statistics classes when we computed the standard deviation, let's say we had a normal distribution and we wanted to compute the standard deviation from of the mean. So if you think back of central limit theorem and stuff, so you compute a sample mean, and then what's the standard deviation of that sample mean in considering the central limit theorem? So what you would have is usually the standard deviation of the sample divided by square root n. Or if we talk about the variance, this would be divided by n, right? So in other statistics classes, you have surely seen it before. This would be our standard error of the mean. Sorry, this would be the standard error of the mean. So because, And this is what we are having here now. So here, this is our proportion data. And then we just divide. So the proportion data, this would be, let me use a different color. This would be the standard deviation, right? And we divide the standard deviation by square root n. So that's what I'm doing here. We can just write it as follows, which is basically what I'm writing here. So yeah, this is how, so we just define the standard error. So why do we do that? We are going to use that for the confidence interval using the same methods you are already familiar with from other statistics classes when you did a one sample confidence interval and stuff like that. So what is a confidence interval again? Roughly speaking, a confidence interval of some parameter is an interval that is expected to contain the parameter with a certain probability. So for example, 95 is usually a common one. You can do 90 or 99. So 90% confidence interval will be narrower, and 99% confidence interval will be wider. In practice, 95 is usually a number that most people use for many different things. For completeness, the more precise definition of a confidence interval, because we are still in statistics. So it's if you would draw samples repeatedly from the given distribution that you are assuming. So here we are assuming a normal distribution. So if you would draw repeatedly from a normal distribution, a lot of times you would expect that using the method for the 95% confidence interval, if we would construct 95% confidence interval for this infinitely large number of samples, we would find that 95% of these confidence intervals would contain the true parameter. Okay, I said multiple times normal distribution. Why do we assume that the data can be drawn from a normal distribution? Yeah, that is in fact because the binomial distribution will be similar to a normal distribution if we have a large number of trials. So here I don't even have a large number of trials. Well, let me start here at the top. So here at the top, I was just quickly in Python sampling from a standard normal distribution, so unit variance and zero mean. I was just drawing a crazy large number, so that looks rather smooth here. And you can see when I now use a binomial distribution, so here at the bottom I'm sampling from a binomial distribution, again a crazy number of times, but here I'm using only, so as a parameter is n100, the number of trials, I'm setting it to 100, and the probability here to 0.2. So this is like a relatively small number of trials, right? So just demonstrating that even for a relatively small number like 100, in machine learning we usually have test sets that are larger than 100 samples, that we get something that already resembles the shape of a standard normal distribution. Not standard normal distribution, because the x-axis is different, but a normal distribution. But yeah, nonetheless, the data will be normal distributed. So, and then when we construct the confidence interval, we use this normal approximation idea because it's less tedious to draw a confidence interval for the binomial distribution with this normal approximation. And as a rule of thumb, this works or is recommended if n is larger than 40 and np and n1 minus p should be both greater than 5. So in that if these conditions are satisfied, then it's recommended to, it's usually said that it's okay to use a normal approximation interval. It won't be too far off. Okay, so and then the z-value. So we would get the z-value from the standard normal distribution if you look at z-tables, for example. So looking at z-tables, for a 95% confidence interval, what we would have is we would look at the value such that 2.5% of the data is below this threshold that we want to look up, right? And that is because the confidence interval is symmetric. So we have also on the other side here 2.5%. So for the 95% confidence interval, this should be actually minus 1.96. We would find the value z equals 1.96. So we take the absolute value. And that is our value for the 95% confidence interval. If you want to draw a 99% one, you have to choose a smaller value. For 99% a larger value, because it will be wider. And for a 90% confidence interval, smaller value, because the confidence interval will be narrower. Okay, so just putting this together in code, we will compare this confidence interval, by the way, to the resampling based confidence intervals later. But here's just a quick code example. So assume you have some classifier. You fit the classifier, and then yeah, you can compute the accuracy. So I was giving it such a weird name because this is from the code notebook that I used here at the bottom to compare this method to other bootstrap-based confidence intervals. So you can check this code out here. But yeah, you can also just wait until we cover it in this lecture. So first we fit the classifier, and then here we evaluate it on the test set. So we are using the scikit-learn.score function. This is computing the classification accuracy. So this is the accuracy. Slides before were on the error, but the same concept works for the accuracy, of course. It's also still a proportion in the range between 0 and 1. Then we multiply it by our z value. So this is the standard error. And this is it. Then we have our lower and upper confidence interval here, so which would be between 0.87 and 1.04. Okay, so this was the normal approximation interval, and later in this lecture we will then construct confidence intervals based on the bootstrap methods, several bootstrap methods. So in the next lecture we will be talking about resampling and the repeated holdout, and then about empirical confidence intervals.